Okay, so our next speaker is Pedro Santana, and he's talking about chance-constrained consistency for probabilistic temporal plan networks.
Perfect. Thank you very much. So good morning, everyone. So I'm Pedro. I came here to present joint work with Professor Brian Williams at MIT. And the purpose of this work was, you know, our goal was to bring the concept of risk-aware execution to high-level temporal mission planning. And, you know, like, you know, Newton said, and it's usually the case in research, you have, you know, in order to see further, you have to stand on the shoulders of giants. So these are my giants. So this is basically what this work does. It extends the concepts of consistency that were initially proposed by Tsarmadinos and others for conditional temporal plans. These concepts were themselves derived from the controllability guarantees for simple temporal networks with uncertainty. And then what I did is I combined that with risk guarantees that you usually have for stochastic CSPs or for low-level path planning that have been proposed before. So, but then the question is, well, why exactly did I want to do that? So why do we need risk when we're talking about temporal mission planning? So the problem is, so here are like two motivating kind of like teasers about why I did that. So first is by Benazirai in like a paper of his work at NASA, where he was saying, what he was saying is that, you know, the 1997 mission to Mars spent most of its time doing nothing on the surface of the planet, because, you know, what happens is you make a plan and you assume that everything is going to happen according to plan, what was expected. And when things don't happen as expected, what you do is you halt execution and you try to be safe at all times. So, I mean, it does keep things safe, but it kind of like wastes a lot of like valuable time that you could be using if you had a little more autonomy. And the same thing, for example, every time for the people who flew here, you know, unfortunately, every time you board a plane, there is a zero risk. There is a non-zero risk of the plane crashing and eventually you dying, but probably everyone took the plane because these risks can be managed and they can be bounded. So, and that's one of the suggestions from the FAA risk management handbook. So since you cannot make it zero, at least you should have a maximum risk threshold. So that's exactly what we tried to do in this work. So the main contributions were, so we took the consistency guarantees that we had originally for CTPs, and we extended them to the case where your temporal plans have controllable choices, which means that you have the alternative to choose different paths to execute, different ways to execute an action. We provided algorithms for the cases of weak and strong chance-constrained consistency. Dynamic consistency is on the works, so please ask me about it. I will be happy to talk about the current work. And finally, we came up for the strong consistency check. We came up with a diagnostic approach. That is not only, I mean, it's quite useful for the temporal planning, but it could potentially be used for any type of conditional CSP using pretty much the same framework. So without further ado, let's see the overview and start by telling you what I mean by chance constraint consistency of PTPN stands for probabilistic temporal plan networks. Sorry. So for the rest of this talk, I'm going to use this super simple, fairly toy example. But the good thing is that it has pretty much all the features that I would like to demonstrate. So the goal here is pretty simple. So what happens is you have the helicopter at the bottom, and your goal is to take the supplies, fly to one of the helipads, and then for, you know, security concerns, you don't want to fly directly to the Red Cross. So what you want to have is have a truck drive and then deploy, you know, deliver your resources. And the thing is, I'm assuming that, you know, the closer you are to the Red Cross, the highest reward, or the smaller the cost. In this case, the highest reward you get. But also, the closer you are to the river, the highest the probability of, you know, the road being flooded in, and that might affect how much time it will take for you to drive. So what you're trying to do here is actually to come up with a schedule in this. So you can take this problem and you can model it as a probabilistic temporal plan network, which you can see on the slide. So the first, the double circle on the far left, is the only controllable choice that you have, which is the choice of your landing site. And each one of them has an R, which stands for reward. Each one of them has different values for reward. You have the arcs with the brackets. These represent simple temporal constraints between the events. In this work, I'm going to be talking about simple temporal constraints that are controllable. The uncontrollable case is also on the works with many bright people in the group. Please ask me about it if you like. But in this case, we assume that they are controllable, and the double dash circles are sensing actions. So they are observables that you can get from the environment, and they will ultimately affect the temporal constraint, and you have an overall temporal constraint of 30 minutes to reach your goal. On the far left, you have a probabilistic model of how the sensing action happens, and we're going to impose, we're going to say that, you know, this PTPN, we're going to allow it a 2% risk of failure, which I call a chance constraint. By risk of failure, in this case, is the risk of violating, of having an infeasible schedule or violating your temporal constraints. So I'm probably, you know, telling you things that you already know, but, you know, just give you a primer on what I mean by weak consistency and the chance constraint extension. So when we talk about weak consistency and strong consistency, we're basically talking. So for weak consistency, it's the situation where, you know, if someone were to tell you the true value of the observables in your scenario, you would be able to come up with a set of choices and a schedule that is feasible. On the other hand, on the exact opposite side of the scale, you have strong consistency, which is, well, assume that I cannot observe the observables, but I still have to come up with a policy that works in every case. So if your plan is strongly consistent, I can come up with this policy, guaranteed. It's an analogous concept to conformant planning. So the problems here is, you know, for weak consistency, the problem is, you know, it's very easy to refute weak consistency. You can just give me an execution where it fails, one scenario where it fails. But it's very hard to actually, like, verify it. It's actually coin P complete. Strong consistency, actually not that hard to verify. But it's usually the case that its plans are not strongly consistent, so you cannot find a conformant plan, just because it tends to be the case that your reward plans are overly constrained. So if you add a chance constraint extension, which is the CC, what it allows you is for weak consistency, instead of actually having to enumerate all of your possible scenarios that you might ever encounter, it allows you to just focus your attention on the most likely set of scenarios that you might encounter, and then, you know, come up with execution policy for those. And in the case for a strong consistency, what is actually happening is that instead of trying to be able to every possible scenario that is not observable by your policy, what we're trying to say is, you know, instead of being consistent with probability one, I'm going to be consistent with high probability. And the high probability is one minus the risk threshold that you're given. So as you can see, the chance constraints, so while they all provide you with explicit safety guarantees, so they actually provide you with a bound on how likely your policy or execution is to succeed. In the case of weak consistency, they aid you with intractable enumeration that is involved with the standard concept. And for strong consistency, they allow you to steer away from worst case analysis. So for the rest of the talk, I'm going to focus on the particular case of strong consistency, because the algorithm is actually applicable to other kinds of CSPs. If you want to see, if you want to learn about how we do weak consistency, it's kind of like the standard way. For chance constraints, you can look at the paper. And so this is a very verbose way of saying, so you are given the PTPN that you saw before in terms of, you know, so we have given a temporal plan that has controllable choices, observables, a probability distribution of your observables, and a risk bound. And what you wanted to find is a policy. And by policy, what I mean is an assignment to your choices, the controllable choices that you have, and a scheduling policy, which means a dispatchable network that you can actually find a schedule from that is that you can execute. And I want this policy to have high probability of being, of actually solving a true scenario underlying your execution. And then you can use that to dispatch your plan. So an example output for this type of problem, and that's the output that is going to be generated from our toy problem, is, for example, the assignments to the choices would be to choose the secondary site, and then the scheduling policy for the drive fly activities would be those, and the test completion is that overall temporal constraint over there. And the success probability, as you're going to see, is going to be 98.7%, which means a risk of 1.3, which is less than our chance constraint. So, all right, so let's see how that works. So the key insights for determining strong consistency, chance constraint, strong consistency are twofold. First, in the standard way that strong consistency is defined, it's usually the case that you, if you test for strong consistency, the algorithm will return no solution, and you will say, there is no way you can guarantee consistency in this case. But that's usually in real-world problems. That's usually because of a small set of very hard and usually and likely scenarios. So we're kind of like throwing a whole range of possibilities out because of this small set of scenarios. And the other thing is, the standard approach in stochastic CSPs or in many other risk-aware approaches is to actually do a scenario enumeration. So what you do is you enumerate your scenarios in terms of the observables that you might get, and then what you do is you collect their probability and you collect their constraints. Here what we try to do is say, well, instead of trying to do the search in the space of, the uncontrollable choices, what if we try to diagnose why a plan is being feasible in terms of the conflicts between the constraints, and we map that back to a whole subspace of uncontrollable choices. And I'm going to tell you very quickly how that works. So in that PTPN that I showed you before, you could extract these labeled constraint representations. These are like standard representations for conditional CSPs and conditional temporal problems. What it actually tells you is, on the left-hand side, you have a conjunction of assignments to choices. The blue ones are controllable choices. The pink ones are the uncontrollable because they're like pretty colors. And then on the right-hand side, what it's saying is, if the label on the left holds true, the constraint on the right should be met. It's part of your plan. So, and then what you can do, you can choose to search in the space of uncontrollable events, or you can choose to search in the space of constraints. What usually happens is that searching in the space of uncontrollable events tends to be larger than the number of elements in the space of constraints, mostly because you usually have multiple choices activating a single constraint. And second, the constraints are actually the thing that causes infeasibility. So it's the conflict between constraints that will cause a plan to be infeasible. If you search in the space of uncontrollable events, you are indirectly mapping to that subspace. So we said, well, what if we, try to, once again, what if we learn the reasons why constraints are infeasible and we just map to these two like whole subspaces of uncontrollable events? And I will show you very quickly a very simple example of how you could do that. It's actually very simple. So assume that you have four labeled constraints, L1 and place C1 and so on. So arbitrarily, let's choose that C1 and C3 and C2 and C4 are conflicting. So they cannot coexist in the plan. They are not jointly feasible. So if you go from a diagnostic approach, what you would say is, well, you're going to try to find a diagnosis in the form of a kernel assignment that actually resolves all the conflicts that you have so far. So below you have all the kernel assignments that you can have for the conflicts that are shown above, and let's choose one of them, the first, also arbitrarily. So let's suppose that we have this diagnosis here in terms of restoring feasibility of constraints. How do you map that back into risk? And it's actually quite simple. So if L1 implies C1, it's clear that not C1 implies not L1. So if you take the model and you combine them, what you end up having is that a kernel diagnosis in the space of constraints actually implies a disjunction in the space of labels. And then you might say, well, but computing that probability over there is exponentially hard in the worst case. That's true. However, you can see in the paper, you can actually make these very, like, these iterative polynomial approximations of your probabilities, because we don't really care about the value of the risk. We just want to know if it's above or below some bound. So you can actually have polynomial approximations to that probability that you can iteratively refine. And since we are dealing with a conjunction of labels, risk is going to be a monotonic function. So therefore, if you just do the greedy thing, which is choose the kernel or choose the diagnosis with the minimum risk, if you ever find a schedule, you are guaranteed that's the one with the minimum risk. And the fact that it's the one with minimum risk actually allows you to backtrack quickly. And I'm going to show you on a very simple example. So prior art, when I say prior art, I mean the conditional temporal plan, conditional temporal problem framework, where uncertainty is set bounded. What it means is that you don't actually have a probabilistic model. And what you're saying is that you want risk zero. You want your plan to succeed in every possible case. So in this case, what you would do is say, well, this possible choice is infeasible because there is an execution over there that is infeasible. Same thing for the second choice. And the only actually strongly controllable or strongly consistent execution is the one at the bottom. On the other hand, if you were to use a chance constraint approach, what you could say is, instead of ruling out the top two just by saying, well, there exists an execution that is infeasible. You actually compute a risk. And then, for example, we're going to see that the risk for the one on the top is 5.1%. The risk for the one in the middle is 1.3%. And the risk for the one at the bottom, that since there is no uncertainty in that path, is zero. Of course, you don't actually have to compute this for every possible execution. Once you find one that maximizes the reward, you can just stop. So let's see how that goes in a simple example. So our overall approach is the standard diagnosis approach, which is generated in test. So you generate a candidate set of controllable choices that will maximize the reward. And when I say reward, is some sort of preference function defined over your controllable choices. Given these candidate choices, what you're actually doing is you're splitting your temporal constraints into sets, and then you're going to try to find, so the green set is the set of all the constraints that are necessarily active. The yellow set is the set that depends on choices that you have made and uncontrollable, you have sensing actions. And the red set you can just ignore because these have been deactivated by your choices. So once you have that, what you try to do is to find a temporal constraint network that meets your risk constraint. If you can do that, you just backtrack until you either run out of candidates or you validate your risk constraint. So let's see, let me go quickly on this example. So for example, if you go for the first choice, you get these constraints. The green ones are the constraints that must hold. The yellow ones are the constraints that hold depending on uncontrollable things. So they are jointly infeasible. And you can actually do, since we're dealing with simple temporal constraints, you can actually test this incrementally very efficiently. So now the question is, well, is there a way that I could remove constraints from my plan while guaranteeing my risk bounds? And without even doing the consistency check, what you can do is, for example, if I choose that constraint to remove from my problem, the risk associated is the probability of that label, which is given below, which is 5.1%, which is greater than the chance constraint, and it violates the risk bound. So I don't even have to keep trying anything here because this single removal here already validates my risk bound. So I can just backtrack from this point on and not do any other chance consistency checks. So I backtrack, I go to the first stage, and then I choose the secondary site with these constraints. Following exactly the same procedure, I would come to the conclusion that, for example, if you remove the bottom constraint, you have a risk of 98.7%, so you would start by trying to remove the one at the top, which has a risk of 1.3%. So the risk is okay, so it actually pays off to try to see if these constraints are jointly feasible. And in this case, they are. So what we have actually achieved with this, you have by taking these constraints jointly, you have actually marginalized over the dependency on the uncontrollable variable. And the output is exactly the same one that I showed you before. So in terms of results, we tried the diagnostic approach against the scenario enumeration approach for small problem sizes, and these have been randomly generated. I apologize for that. But these have been randomly generated. The diagnostic approach and the scenario enumeration approach, they perform pretty much the same for small problem sizes, but as the problem size grows, you can see that there is an exponential growth in the scenario enumeration approach. Actually, in this particular case, what was happening is that you had a small set of constraints that were hard to meet, but with that high probability of being executed. So the scenario enumeration would always try not to remove them so as to not incur a lot of risk. So it would actually take, whereas the diagnostic approach just learns what the conflicting sets of constraints, irrespective of their probabilities, and then just maps back to the risk and figures it out. Since we're trying to do realistic plans, we try to see if things would grow nicely. You can see there is an exponential trend in the growth, even for not that many temporal constraints in your problem. So there is a lot of work to do still, but at least it's encouraging that the diagnostic approach could actually perform well. And for my summary and conclusion, so just to recap, this work presented an extension of the existing concepts of consistency for conditional temporal plans to the case where you have chance constraints and offers you explicit guarantees on the risk. Two important steps is first, derive the dynamic consistency checks, which are on the works. I would be happy to talk about it and answer any questions. And also incorporate, so in this, I have shown you here the case where we're only dealing with controllable temporal constraints. So we have to incorporate the uncertainty comes from the uncontrollable durations. Thank you very much.
So we have one very quick question.
Yes.
Thank you. When you talk about risk sensitive, let me give an example. It's similar like I want to have a plan to get home in 1 hour, but with more than 19% probability, something like this, is that right? Okay. So I have two questions. The first one is, this is kind of a, I mean, your work is kind of a satisfaction problem. Have you think about optimization problem is like, say, I want to get home in 1 hour, but I want maximum probability to achieve that. Okay, this is the first question. And the second question is, let's say, even I have this constraint as a satisfaction, then there must be more than one plan to can achieve that. I mean, there will be more than one plan can be get home, can get home and with more than 90% probability. So do you have criteria to pick one? Let's see, so your purpose is just that I get one, then I'm fine. Or you still have criteria, let's see, almost those plan, all those plan have more than 90% probability, but I still have criteria to pick one best, a best one. Let's see, maybe with minimized cost or maximum reward.
All right. I'll try to answer both. So great. So the first one, when we're trying to say, that's a great question. So people, and people usually ask that, which is, why aren't you trying to minimize risk or maximize the probability of success? So the thing is, usually what happens is if you try to minimize risk, so for example, the minimum possible risk here is zero. And we saw in, the, for example, the set bound approach, that you know, in this slide, there exists an execution with zero risk, which is like take the bottom path, which is lowest possible reward. So the thing is, reward or cost, and whatever the objective function that you're trying to optimize, and risk are kind of like competing goals. So it's instead of, so you could, for example, combine them in some sort of like convex combination as a single utility and try to maximize or minimize a combination of them, but then you have to actually trade off cost by risk, which is which are not exactly comparable quantities. So in our approach, what we try to say is we're going to use risk as a constraint as opposed to an objective. So what we try to say is, well, if you define an admissible risk bound in terms of, you know, if you want a plan to succeed with some probability and you, what we try to do is to come up with the best possible plan in terms of agility that still meets that chance constraint. So we're actually trying to exploit risk in our favor, which is exactly what we're trying to say. So if everything might go wrong, it's always nice to exploit risk. And for the second question, yes, we are not trying, we do not return the solution with the smallest risk overall. Overall, for example, we return the solution with 1.3 risk, even though the overall minimal risk is zero. However, so first thing, we don't actually return one single solution because we return a dispatchable network. So you can actually, from that, you can derive a whole family of schedules. So you can actually use that to add flexibility as opposed to having a single schedule. And the second is, at least for the set of your set of controllable choices that you make that maximize your utility or optimize your utility, for that specific case, since we're using, since you know, risk in the way it is defined, it's kind of like independent of the probability distribution. Since it's a monotonic function of the constraints that you remove, if you just do a greedy kernel selection in your diagnostic process, you're guaranteed to attain the minimum risk conditional on those sets of constraints. So so that's what we've tried to do.
Okay. All right. Okay. Let's thank the speaker again.